Hey guys, today we're taking a look at desulfating 12-volt lead-acid batteries with the YIHUA 605D and magnesium sulfate, also known as Epsom salts. So I'm going to show this in kind of two parts. Normally you'd kind of combine them, but first we're doing a forced overcharge, which is also known as an equalizing charge. And essentially what that is you set your charger to between 15 and 16 volts, and you kind of hook that up to the battery. And as you can imagine, this really tries to overcharge the battery. And one thing you're going to see is the current is sitting at about 5 volts here, which is about what this charger will spit out at the top. And I'm going to end up turning that down a little bit just because you're going to end up with a lot of heat generated if you've got too much current going in. One thing to note is you do want to monitor the battery when you're doing this because it can heat up and you're going to get a lot of gassing happening, and which is essentially, it almost looks like kind of boiling coming out of the cells. And that's, hydrogen and oxygen coming out. And you do want to do this in a ventilated space. That's very important, and you want to keep sparks far away because the hydrogen gas that comes out during venting, which can happen sometimes when using a normal charger, is very explosive. It's actually, it'll ignite at a tenth of what gasoline ignites at. So as you can imagine, that's very dangerous. Like even an invisible spark from like a little static shock can cause it to ignite. You'll notice that I've popped off the caps as well. That's because of the pressure buildup. Normally the caps will vent in this case, but just in case they're plugged, you don't want a situation where, you know, the cap's going to end up blowing off from overpressure. Now I've just kind of checked those cells to make sure that, you know, I do have enough liquid in there. And now I've moved over to an AGM battery, absorbed glass mat, which you don't actually kind of fill up completely with water. It's got a glass mat that you have to be careful with when you're putting in some fluid. But we'll look at that a little bit later. Right now, just getting back to, you know, kind of how explosive things are, I'm going to hook up a 9-volt battery just to this kind of electrolyte here, and you can see little kind of jets or streams coming up every time it touches. And this is actually hydrogen gas being produced and oxygen gas being produced. So this is essentially what happens in your car battery when you're overcharging it. Remember, this is just a little 9-volt battery and some electrolytes. So you can imagine with a 12-volt battery kind of the dangers there. So you want to be extremely careful when charging the battery to keep shocks and everything else like that away. Now I'm going to switch over right away to another clip before we go into the magnesium sulfate. Okay, I'm going to try and quickly show you how sulfation kind of comes about and then kind of how we fix it. So first we've got a very simple diagram of a battery, and I'm going to skim over this as fast as I kind of can, so feel free to pause if you want to read something. But we've got a simple battery here, and we've got a couple plates, lead dioxide for one and lead for the other. You don't have to necessarily remember which is which, but just keep in mind that this is kind of some of the primary components of a lead acid battery. Now, typically, the liquid inside the battery is a mix of water and sulfuric acid. So basically, a third of the liquid is sulfuric acid. And this is also why they say if you have, you know, kind of charged up your battery and, you know, some stuff kind of evaporated over time and then you have to go and refill it, that's why they say only use distilled water, because it's actually the water that either gassed away or evaporated away. And if you were to refill with sulfuric acid, you'd kind of mess up that ratio, and that wouldn't be good. So we'll just shrink that down a little bit. And I'm going to change the colors because we're going to throw the chemical equation that happens when you drain a battery. And in plain English, what this is saying is that you've got the lead and lead dioxide plates. They combine with the sulfuric acid in the battery to become lead sulfate and water. Now, lead sulfate, which I'm going to turn into purple, is kind of the bad stuff that builds up on the plates. This is kind of when a battery is sulfated, that's basically saying that you've got lead sulfate that builds up on the plates. Water is the other byproduct. And that is why if it is minus 20 outside and you left your headlights on with the car off and you came back the next day and, you know, you're like, oh, the battery's dead. If you decide, well, it's too cold today, I'll come back and take a look tomorrow. Well, you might come back the next day only to find out that your battery froze and cracked and split. And that's because the water would have frozen because you don't have that sulfuric acid in there anymore. Well, you have some sulfuric acid, but not enough to keep things from freezing. So we'll shrink that a little bit. Now we've kind of drained a battery here. We've showed kind of what things might look like inside when it's been drained. If the battery is recharged without waiting too long, the process is mostly but not completely reversed. So this is essentially why when you first start up your car, well, let's see what happens. You turn the key, a whole bunch of juice comes out of the battery and goes to the starter to turn over your engine. Well, that actually sucks a lot of juice out of the battery. But fortunately, your car probably has an alternator, which charges the battery up again right away. so you don't have that lead sulfate, sitting there for a long time. So basically you get maybe a little soft sulfation happening, but then it's reversed and everything is okay. That being said, if you kill a battery and then you decide you're going to just put it on a shelf for a couple weeks, instead of soft sulfation, you're going to have what's called hard sulfation. Basically, that lead sulfate is going to turn into some hard crystals that are almost bonded with the lead. And if you try and hook that battery up to a car charger a couple weeks later, you're going to find out that, hey, the battery is not taking a charge anymore. And that hard sulfate is really tough to break away from those plates. It's really hard to reverse. So, how would we desulfate a battery? Well, there are three common ways. The first one is called a forced overcharge or an equalization charge. Now, the primary purpose of this is not actually to reverse sulfation. What this actually does is it tries to bring some of the weaker cells up to a higher voltage, and so it might do some desulfating in that in those weaker cells, but it isn't really a full-on desulfation technique. It does work okay with chemical sulfation, though, which we'll look at shortly. The other way is through pulse desulfators, and these are devices that you've probably seen on eBay or maybe on Amazon. They all work a little bit differently. There's patents on just about everything that these things use, so even if you were to just from scratch try and design something, if it worked really good and you decided to try and sell that product, you'd probably be sued by dozens of companies because you would have unknowingly infringed on a bunch of, basic patents. But anyway, they work in a couple different ways. One way is to do something like throw, say, 60 volts at the battery, for a fraction of a second at a time. And the other way is to use pulses at resonant frequencies, basically to try and create, kind of microscopic vibrations within the battery to break the lead sulfate free. As to whether those pulse desulfators work or not, some people have success, some people try a whole bunch of them on a whole bunch of batteries and don't have success, so feel free to give them a shot, but make sure you don't spend too much money without finding out whether it works or not. And finally, we've got chemical desulfation, which we're going to be actually kind of using. Now, we're going to be mixing this with a forced overcharge when we get back to the actual kind of video part of things. But just be aware that chemical desulfation is something that's been known since the late 1800s. Lead-acid batteries are extremely old technology, and when they first had it, well, they tried a whole bunch of different chemicals and salts to see what the effects were on all sorts of battery things, including the effect on sulfation. So, there are two very common salts that are used for chemical desulfation, which you'll probably read a lot about if you do a little bit of research. The first one, and kind of the most popular one because it's considered to be one of the best ones, is using what's called sodium sulfate. Now, sodium sulfate is actually used as a filler in laundry detergents, those powdered laundry detergents, but it's not really found in common household things that you might find. So you're not going to be, I got a box of sodium sulfate in the garage or whatever. No, this is usually something you'll have to find at either a chemical supply company or that you can order from eBay. You can get, a certain amount for about $10 or something like that. The other thing that's commonly used is magnesium sulfate. And that one is something you might have in your home. If you have Epsom salts, also known as Epsom bath salts, those are made of magnesium sulfate. And they're not considered to be as good as sodium sulfate, but a lot of people do use them, and they do tend to work, whether they work close to as well as sodium sulfate or not nearly as well. It's a little tough to say without doing a whole bunch of kind of back-to-back A/B tests. But anyway, those are kind of the two most common ones used. And the equation that you see here, I'm not going to actually go over. This is from some of those documents that were mentioned previously, and I'll have them in the notes below, the stuff from the late 1800s. But this is essentially kind of the equation they came up with to, that kind of explained what they were seeing when they were doing tests with sodium sulfate on unsulfated batteries. So we'll stop with this part here, and we'll go back to actually doing stuff physically to the battery. Okay, so we're back to the battery. Now I've got a cup of distilled water, I've got a little measuring spoon, and I've also got a bag of magnesium sulfate, also known as Epsom salt. And to do this, what you'd normally do is mix that Epsom salt in with some distilled water, which you can pretend I've done in a cup, and then you'll use a syringe to put it in each of those little holes there. So you try and measure it, fairly accurately, and then when it comes time to actually, pour it into the holes, you want to kind of watch and You're going to see a little bit of the glass mat if you look inside the holes very carefully. You won't be able to see it in this video, unfortunately. But you kind of watch and see how quickly it absorbs. And when it starts getting to the point where it's not absorbing very quickly, at that point you can kind of assume that, okay, it's pretty saturated and I don't want to put any more liquid in. So for this type of battery, you don't want to actually fill it until you see water. You just want to fill it until that glass mat stops really absorbing. Now, moving over to a more typical like car battery here, one thing that you could do is you could just take the Epsom salt and in the spoon measure out maybe a quarter of a teaspoon to half a teaspoon or something like that and dump it in each of the cells. That's not the greatest way to do it because it won't necessarily mix with the water, and if you get really unlucky it might drop in there in a way that's going to short the cells. So normally what you would want to do is again mix it with distilled water beforehand and then carefully add it at that point. You do want to make sure when you hook it back up to the charger again that you are above the plates, but again not too high, because when you go ahead now and do kind of the real charge, forced overcharge, you're going to have a situation where that electrolyte is kind of gassing or boiling and that sort of thing, and you don't want it to spill over. But you do want to pay attention all the time while this is charging. You don't want to leave it for 24 hours and come back the next day. You want to be kind of checking back every once in a while and make sure you've still got enough electrolyte, that it hasn't boiled over, and once everything's all said and done you can kind of put the caps back on. But in this case, I'm keeping the caps off because I don't want them to blow off unexpectedly during the charging process. So that's briefly kind of covering everything. I didn't want the video to go too long. I mean, we're already over 11 minutes here, but hopefully that gives you kind of a rough idea as to how you can go about. And I definitely encourage you to do some research as you continue on, and I wish you the best of luck. Until next time.